Information phone 510-526-9105 or www.poetryflash.org.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, KPFB in Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact.
This is a great indictment to America and to the world that the hatred of dark skin is so great that they could watch it on national and international TV for 6 days before help came.
When you make human contact with the level of suffering and just an outrageous mistreatment of these people, you will be moved to take action, not just charitable action, but political action.
In the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, what's happening in the Gulf Coast? On this second part of a special series, we'll talk about grassroots organizations mobilizing to do the work the U.S. government cannot or will not do. And we'll take a look at the issue of environmental justice. How much does race and poverty play a role in where Americans live? I'm Tina Rubio, your host this week on Making Contact, a program creating connections between people, vital ideas, and important information. 1 million hurricane survivors are now displaced in 34 different areas of the United States, many trying to start new lives in places they've never been. That's why one grassroots organization is helping to mobilize a national network of activists called ResurrectNewOrleans.org. It gives people across the nation a place to plug in through charitable means and political action. Van Jones, executive director for the Ella Baker Center for Human Rights, based in Oakland, California, is spearheading the task. Making Contact's Emily Polk sat down with Jones to talk about this call to action.
The main thing that we're calling for right now is for people to let the survivors speak. We're calling for what we're calling grassroots truth commissions all across the country, just getting people together in church basements and high school gymnasiums, in places of worship, where the people who are the survivors, the people who were left behind, the people who only by a miracle were able to survive their abandonment, get a chance to speak from their heart about what happened.
Who is going to hear this?
Well, from our point of view, if in your hometown or in your city, there's, you know, one person who's a survivor of the flooding in New Orleans or the catastrophe in the Gulf Coast, that person, if they go to a place of worship, if they go to a high school gymnasium and just sit down with a microphone and tell their story, you will be able to get elected officials in the room to listen, faith leaders in the room to listen, community activists in the room to listen. There's not a single person in the country whose heart does not go out to these survivors. And that's just based off what people saw on television. When you make human contact with the level of suffering and just the outrageous mistreatment of these people, you will be moved to take action, not just charitable action, but political action.
When do you hope this will happen?
Well, we think that it should start immediately. We did an event like this in Oakland, California. We had about 200 people. After 4 hours, people wouldn't leave. We were trying to get people out of the door. People were so much wanting to be supportive to the survivors that we have here in Oakland, California. That's true of people in every city. We have a diaspora from the Gulf Coast in our nation in at least 34 states. So people in 34 states can not only give food and medicine and clothing and money, they can also give their political and moral support to ensuring that these people are not put in substandard housing, ensuring that the survivors' children are respected in the school system, ensuring that the federal government abandon its sink or swim policies that have resulted in this catastrophe. One of the things that we have to take responsibility for, these people, a lot of the people who were left behind in New Orleans when the hurricane came, they were left behind a long time ago by our federal government, by the national media. And now is the time for us to say the sink or swim policies and mindset that's kind of infected the country over the past 10 years, the past 15 years. It is time for those ideas to drown in New Orleans. We need to take a new turn in this country to re-embrace the poor, to re-embrace people of color, to invest wisely in the infrastructure in our country, to make sure that this never happens again.
So one of the ways you're going to do this is by having communities gather, tell their stories. What are other ways?
The charitable action response we think is really critical, but we also think it has to be matched with political action. When people come together at these community speak outs, these truth commissions, we want to make sure that there are cell phones and laptops right there on the spot, so any advocacy needs that are there can be met. You know, pick up your cell phones, take them out of your purses. You've heard what's going on. You know, call the governor, call the mayor. One of the things that we're seeing happen now is that as each town and city tries to absorb the refugees, so-called refugees, the displaced persons, each town and city is running into different problems. Sometimes people who are already poor suddenly see this new influx of poor people getting so much attention that they have resentment. We have to deal with that. Sometimes people want to take people in to their homes, but landlords are saying, hey, wait a minute, you only can have 3 people on this lease, now you have 10. City governments need to step forward and have 9 and 10, 12-month amnesties for renters who want to take in their family members and other people who are survivors. There are so many things that when you have 1 million displaced people in a country that have to be taken care of, I couldn't list them all, but I will say this, it starts from making human contact with the survivors, asking them what their needs are. What trouble are they running into with the school board? What trouble are they running into with the county hospital? What trouble are they running into with finding quality housing? And then it moves from there. When you're dealing with the diaspora, people who are in diaspora have 3 rights. They have a right to survive, they have a right to thrive, and they have a right to return. The right to survive, the federal government dropped the ball on. We have to ensure that people can survive, that the people who are sick as a result of the toxic waters get the medicine they need, regardless of their income. They also have a right to thrive, and those billions should be spent in that way.
Tell me about some of the groups you're working with.
You know, there are groups all across the country who are coming together. There's a group called FLIC in Louisiana, which is Families of Louisiana Incarcerated Children. Organization, FLIC, has been doing incredible work trying to locate all the kids who were behind bars for various reasons in Louisiana, some of whom have gone missing in the flood. We're definitely encouraging the support of the Juvenile Justice Project in Louisiana. We are strong supporters of the Community Labor United effort, which is running the People's Hurricane Fund in Louisiana. So much money is going to Red Cross, and that's great, but there are grassroots-controlled funds, and sometimes local people know better how to spend that money. And the People's Hurricane Fund is one of the local funds that we're trying to support. I also want to make sure that we always keep in mind the face of this tragedy was a black face, but there were Hondurans who were affected, who live in that area, Mexicans who live in that area, 20 to 40,000 Vietnamese who live in that area and have been there for years since the Vietnam War. Some of them stayed away from the cameras and the shelters, and they suffered as a result. And our project, Resurrect New Orleans, is not just about resurrecting New Orleans. It's about really resurrecting a spirit in this country, that we are an all-of-us-together country.
So somebody listening now who is not politically active, who was very upset about what happened, what would you say is the next step for them? You know, people who may not have a lot of money, people who themselves may just be struggling to survive. What can they do?
Well, for people who are political, obviously there are calls going to the U.S. Congress right now saying that they shouldn't keep cutting taxes, that there should be, you know, money reallocated from war expenses to help with the recovery effort. But the reality is that every single person who's listening to this has an opportunity and an obligation to help. People can say, oh, geez, you know, I hope somebody's taking care of this. You know, it's not really my job responsibility. It's not in my mission statement. It's not what I was planning to do this year. That was the problem. When the disaster hit, nobody wanted to take responsibility for the outcome. And so I trust people to follow their own hearts to take action. Local action is about helping individual people in need. It's about making sure that the school boards and the county hospitals and the renters laws and everything are reshaped to accommodate this 1 million people who've been displaced. People, if they're more committed, you know, Working Assets has put out a call collective political action, moveon.org. There are a number of things online, if you're an online person, where you can find different groups taking different steps. I don't want to advocate one policy solution over another, but I just want to advocate that people get into motion, and not just giving toys, though that's important, or writing a check, though that's important, but getting face-to-face with survivors, making this personal, making them a part of your family, and doing for them what you would do for a family member if they were in these dire straits, which means everything from a hug to calling the president.
Now, I know Resurrect New Orleans has talked about rebuilding. How are we going to rebuild this city? How do you address the fact that for many people, this is going to take years, and for many people, you know, they are going to, at this time, find jobs in other places?
Well, Community Labor United in Louisiana is really taking seriously the effort to ensure that people, even in diaspora, survivors, even spread around the country, have a role and a voice, and I think they should be supported. One of the big challenges is, you know, people being spread out and being gone not for weeks but for years. It does make it hard to come home. Here is the key point that cannot be argued or abandoned. The key point is that everyone has a right to return. No policies can be passed, no contracts can be awarded, no property can be seized and reallocated that would prevent someone from having the right to return. Now, people have also the right not to return, and if people make that choice, that's fine. But our concern right now is a land grab. Our concern right now is a profiteering land grab. And the country has to stand up and say no to Halliburton. No to those profiteers who will come in with money ready to go and bright ideas. We have to take a beat in honor of the dead, in honor of the displaced, and make sure that every single penny and every single project that is given a green light is done so in a way that honors them and that honors a democratic and transparent process. That we owe the people of New Orleans and the Gulf Coast, at least that. If we couldn't send them a helicopter to save their lives, can we at least make sure that the property on which their mothers and fathers were buried and where they were raised, at least can the property be respected? We owe the people of the Gulf Coast at least that much respect. We should have saved their lives. If we can't save their lives, can we at least preserve the legacy of the area and protect the ground on which they were raised, that we owe them that?
Van Jones is the founder of the Ella Baker Center. Community Labor United is part of Resurrect New Orleans. It's a coalition of labor and community activists working to help the victims of Hurricane Katrina. They've put out a call to activists and organizations across the country to work on a people's campaign of community redevelopment. I spoke with CLU's Curtis Muhammad.
What are some of the visions for a redeveloped New Orleans?
We're going step by step, a little bit at a time. First thing we want to do is find our people. Second, as we find our people, we want to make sure the spaces are safe to return to. And we've taken teams of scientists and technicians to help us get the city ready to call our people home. We're going in to test the water, to test the soil, to test the air quality, to see what the health conditions are. And once we are satisfied that the health conditions can either be either okay or can be contained or can be fixed, then we are going with teams of architects and architectural engineers to look at structures and foundations to determine if what structures can be repaired. And then we want to bring a team of solar energy people in to solarize block by block, depending on how many people we have to work, and put the electricity in and start the process of cleaning and repairing block by block. And so our call is to people who have skills that can help in this reconstruction area.
Now, do you want the people that have been displaced by this awful event to help out in the redevelopment of the cities?
Without a doubt, we think we can do it. We think if the technicians come and the skilled people come to lead the brigades and the people come, they can learn. They can learn how to do carpentry. They can learn how to use the construction tools and do plumbing and electrical work. We're asking the unions to come with their apprenticeship programs and help. And we've done it before, and it's been done throughout the world before. We need to do it in New Orleans. We're asking the international community to participate in this. We're not sure that we have a government anymore that care anything about us, so we're looking for help everywhere we can get it.
Absolutely. Now, will you be trying to work at all with organizations like FEMA?
No, we at this stage, ma'am, I mean, I don't know. All of these agencies were looking right at our people sitting in that bowl of water preparing to drown. And they watched us on national TV. We watched our government, our military, every damn body watch us die for 6 days and did nothing. So we have no dependency on that, those people. The government and its agencies and its people, I mean, Bush, I mean, in our mind, we think these are criminals. We're not interested in the government. We're not expecting the government to help us in any way.
And how do you start addressing these major problems of poverty and racism and disenfranchisement?
This thing is very deep and very sick, and we have taught people how not to talk about it. Black people didn't talk about it. White people didn't talk about it. Nobody talked about racism. And everybody was walking around like racism didn't exist, even though black folks were poorer than they'd ever been in history. So we were in trouble before this happened. What this did is turn the light on it. It turned the light on the existence of racism in America. Because all of America watched our people for 6 days. I mean, I knew busloads of people headed to New Orleans to get our people. I mean, that was just crazy. That was insane. We took care of the World Trade Center the same day it happened. I mean, 2 days later, everybody and his grandmama and all the money and resources in the world was behind that situation. And it wasn't as many people in the World Trade Center as were locked up in that water bowl in New Orleans. When the thing happened over in the east with the big flood, the tsunami, it didn't take us that long to respond. We was all over that, from all over the world. But these poor black faces on national and international television, sitting in a water base with the oceans coming in on them, we watched it, all of us, for 6 days. So this is a great indictment to America and to the world, that the hatred of dark skin is so great that they could watch it on national and international TV for 6 days before help came. There's no excuse for anyone.
For more information about Community Labor United or the Ella Baker Center, log on to our website at radioproject.org. We'll have more in just a moment. You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for cassette or CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. Over the past weeks, there's been a lot of discussion about why the U.S. government was so slow to respond to the victims of Hurricane Katrina. Some say bureaucracy, and others say the war in Iraq. But others point to racism as the source of President Bush's slow response to the disaster. The president's mother and former First Lady Barbara Bush may have inadvertently fueled the fire when she made what many call crass assumptions about how Katrina victims are faring. In case you didn't hear, this is Barbara Bush during a radio interview at the Houston Astrodome with Marketplace.
What I'm hearing, which is sort of scary, is they all want to stay in Texas. Everybody is so overwhelmed by the hospitality. And so many of the people in the arenas here, you know, were underprivileged anyway. This is working very well for them.
Comments like this have certainly fueled the fire that racism might in fact have played a part in the government's slow call to action. Some consider Mrs. Bush's comments merely a symptom of a larger problem, this having to do with how racial discrimination, poverty, and in this case, environmental decay, is thrust into the lives of America's poor. Making Contact's Justin Beck spoke with Louisiana State University professor Dr. Craig Colton. Dr. Colton is an environmental justice expert. He's been researching the environmental history of New Orleans.
Environmental justice, in many people's minds, is an actual movement to secure equitable treatment under the law to people of all races and incomes. That is, to ensure that environmental laws don't produce concentrations of toxic waste sites or municipal landfills near African-American or Hispanic or poor communities. And my study of that is seeks to look at how environmental justice concerns and issues have arisen in New Orleans with the construction of public works programs such as drainage and sewage, which are vitally important in that city. With inadequate drainage, your neighborhoods are prone to flooding, even without a hurricane. Heavy downpours can cause flooding, and in areas that don't have completely functional drainage systems, they can sometimes flood. In addition, in New Orleans, there has been a pattern over time that the lowest ground, the most flood-prone land, is the least desirable real estate. Hence, the poorest quality housing and the least costly housing tends to be built there. These are areas where we've had repeated floods. The new Irish immigrants were severely impacted by floods in 1849. In more recent years, there have been sizable areas of the city where there have been heavy rainfalls. We've had flooding in African-American districts because, in many cases, not just the African-American districts, but many of these are also the poorest districts. But low-income people have suffered inordinately, have suffered environmental injustices in the city over the long haul.
And in particular, through this hurricane, a very acute injustice, wouldn't you say?
We have seen some dramatic examples of environmental injustice, but at the same time, there's been some ironic twists on that. Chalmette suffered very high water. It's largely a suburban community of people who left the city to go to a relatively white neighborhood. The area near the 17th Street Canal was created in the 1920s as a white neighborhood, and the deeds had explicit covenants built into them saying that the property could not be sold to blacks. That area, although those deed covenants have been long outlawed by the Supreme Court, that created a white neighborhood, which was in fact impacted by severe flooding by Hurricane Betsy. It was and still is a white neighborhood. So that's kind of an irony or an ironic twist on racism created a white neighborhood and then put those people in harm's way.
That's very interesting. There's been some talk about, a lot of talk about whether to rebuild or not rebuild New Orleans. What's your take on it? How do you feel about it?
A tremendous amount of the city is still standing. A lot of the city that is appealing to tourists who want to come see the city is still standing and very much intact. Roof damage, fallen branches and limbs, those kind of things. But much of the city is still standing, so it doesn't make any sense to abandon the city when much of the core is still intact. There are some areas that are horribly impacted, where there's been severe flooding. It's my contention that some of those areas, we need to reconsider how they're used. Can we encourage people to leave those areas, to move to slightly higher ground, so that they will be then taking themselves out of harm's way? Can we help them step out of harm's way? Those areas should probably be best used as flood retention basins within the city, with, you know, the lowest areas within this much larger bowl of New Orleans. Over the last 10 years or so, there's been a vigorous struggle in one African-American neighborhood in New Orleans called it's adjacent to the Agricultural Street landfill, a Superfund site. The community there has been agitating and working hard to have the EPA buy them out and relocate them because they recognize the Superfund site as a hazard. If we can help people understand that these lowest areas are a hazard, not in the same category as a Superfund site, but they certainly represent a risk, then perhaps they will want to move. I would not advocate destroying neighborhoods, bulldozing territories, or abandoning the city. But I think there's ways we can humanely encourage people to take themselves out of harm's way and help them get there.
And so as the city rebuilds, do you think, Craig, that it's going to be able to keep its rich and diverse culture?
I would certainly hope so. I think so many of those things, such as the foodways, the unique architectural fabric, the music that has come out of the streets, has too much momentum and too much impetus behind it. There's creative people who live there. There are creative people who are drawn there to participate in those kind of activities. And I think that will survive. I think New Orleans might be scaled back a bit over the long haul, but we might be able to make a more polished jewel of it than it is even today.
You know, I'm sure you've been following some of the national coverage of this. Do you think there's any misconceptions that are being promoted in the coverage? And if so, what do you think that they are?
I've encountered a number of people who seem to think that all of New Orleans is below sea level, and hence that all of it is equally inundated, water up to the rooftops, but I think the images at the same time show that that's not the case. The people at the Superdome were surrounded by water, which is lower ground. The people at the convention center were not. So, but topography matters a great deal. I think that's been misrepresented. I think the notion that ethnic groups or neighborhoods are unwilling to move ignores the facts of New Orleans. There's been tremendous mobility of ethnic groups within the city over the years, and I think with proper incentives and cooperation with agencies, we can have some movement of people out of the most flood-prone, the most dangerous areas of the city in terms of natural hazards. So I think that's a misconception that's been out there. And the whole impact of flooding has not been felt only by African Americans. Certainly, we've seen tremendous suffering. The African American community has been impacted beyond belief. But there's an Asian community out in New Orleans East that I still haven't even seen any reporting on. They're in a very, very low flood-prone area. The Isleños, a Hispanic ethnic group on the southeast side of New Orleans in St. Bernard, largely ignored by the media. So I think there are many different groups in this really rich, culturally rich city of New Orleans who have slipped through the cracks in terms of the media coverage, and that's unfortunate.
Dr. Colton is a Carlos Sauer Distinguished Professor of Geography and Anthropology at Louisiana State University. And so from the flooded streets of the Gulf Coast comes a flood of community activism, hope, and anger. We'll leave you with a taste of those inflamed emotions. Rapper the legendary K.O., who lives minutes from the Houston Astrodome, performs George Bush Doesn't Care About Black People.
She killed me, mom.
I ain't saying he's a gold digger.
I'm in need.
But he ain't messing with no broke niggas.
She killed me, mom.
I ain't saying he a gold digger.
I'm in need.
But he ain't messing with no broke niggas.
I got a weed.
George Bush don't like black people. George Bush don't like black people. George Bush don't like black people. George Bush don't like black people.
Hurricane came through, off the sub round here. Government acting like it's bad luck down here. All I know is that you better bring some trucks round here. Wonder why I got my middle finger up round here. People lives on the line, you declining to help. Since you taking so much time, we surviving ourselves. Just me and my pets and my kids and my spouse. Trapped in my own house looking for a way.
That's it for this edition of Making Contact. Thanks for listening. Special thanks to Pauline Bartoloni, Dan Turner, and Risha Young. Our theme music is by the Charlie Hunter Trio. Making Contact is an independent production funded primarily by generous gifts from people in the community. We are committed to providing a unique forum for voices and opinions not often heard in the mass media. If you'd like to support our work, or if you have ideas for future programs, we'd love to hear from you. For a cassette or CD copy of program number 3905, call the National Radio Project at 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org. Lisa Rudman is our executive director, Justin Beck, associate producer, Dorian Taylor, communications manager, Esther Mania, outreach coordinator, Tom Evans, development associate, Emily Polk, production fellow, and Megan Kaiser and Lawton Chan, production interns. I'm Tina Rubio. Thanks for listening to Making Contact.
Tune in tomorrow to KPFA starting at 8 a.m. for complete live coverage from our emergency team in Texas and for live coverage of the D.C. and San Francisco anti-war marches and rallies. That's all day starting tomorrow here on KPFA with Chris Welch and Larry Bensky in Berkeley, Verna Avery Brown in Washington, our KPFA A team in San Francisco, and Brian Edwards, Tiekert, and the KPFT staff in Texas. That's tomorrow starting at 8 a.m.